Welcome to Nostravia, your weekly Nostra podcast. I'm your host, G70, and BitCarrot is back this week for our interview with Uncle Bob. First up, as always, some shout-outs to our supporters on Fountain. And if you haven't used Fountain, you should definitely give it a try. Bitcoin Enjoying Man boosted us 1,500 sats, and he says, Nostriches, assemble. Toshi Huddle boosted us 2,000 sats. Gossip is going to be massive for Nostra. Happy to hear from Mike, who's helping bring it into existence. Spyro Crunch boosted us something like 1,300 sats in multiple boosts. I'm late, but loving the pod. Owen Lewis is back, 1,200 sats. Great episode as always. Excited to give Gossip a try. Hope some kind dev can build us less technical folks a macOS version. Well, it actually can be compiled for macOS, so someone's just got to package it. Ahaniga boosted us 3,000 sats, just a couple of thumbs up. And Rad V Laddie, 1,000 sats. Thank you, Laddie. And now some updates for some of my favorite projects. Semisol is adding LNBit support to the Nostream relay. And also, Nostream settings are going to be able to be updated using events themselves. I assume they're signed by the owner of the relay. Nostaland is introducing a NIP5 service for Eden and Pura Vida users. Sam Samskis has made this pretty cool tool at nostastuff.com, which is worth checking out. Ricardo Arturo has been doing some live coding sessions, so if there are any new developers out there who want to get started on something and just see how things are done, it might be interesting to watch Ricardo do some live coding. So I guess follow Ricardo and he'll let you know when he's doing that next. John, who's working on the Coracle client, has implemented the gossip model in Coracle. Coracle is really cool for the way it shows threads as well. So that's, if you haven't tried Coracle, give it a try. It's cool. Blogstack.io is an awesome project. If you haven't seen that, it's like a Substack kind of thing. Go have a look. We have an awesome lineup of interviews coming up with some pretty cool people. But the door is always open to anyone who's working on anything Nostra related to come on the podcast. If you want to come on the podcast and talk about your project, just send me over a direct message on Nostra. My pub key is in the show notes. And now onto our interview with Uncle Bob. He doesn't really need much of an introduction because most software engineers know who he is. He's the author of several influential books and also one of the original Agile Manifesto guys.
Do you want to tell us your story of how you got into all this?
How I got into all this Nostra stuff? Well, how far back in time do you want to go? So I've been watching the horror scene of the social networks over the last N years. And it occurred to me about a year ago that the current set of social networks was abysmal and something had to be done about it, because we can't continue to have a messaging exchange that is being dominated by government or corporate agendas. So I recalled my time on the internet from the 1980s, and this is when the internet was like nothing, right? There was a backbone sort of, and it sort of went around the world to educational institutions and military institutions. And anybody who wanted to use it had to dial into one of those hubs or dial into somebody who dialed into one of those hubs. And it was a very sporadic and diversified and stochastic kind of network, right? It was You dialed in and you sent your email. You dialed in and you sent your articles. You dialed in and you sent this and you got stuff back. And it was very, very free. You could say anything you wanted. There was nobody who could moderate it. There was no way to moderate it. You just said whatever you wanted. There were several different applications in those days that mostly software people used. It was used by other people as well, but not nearly like it is today. And one of those applications was NetNews. And in NetNews, you would write articles the kind of the same way you would do it on Facebook. You could write long ones, so it wasn't quite like Twitter, but it was very much like Facebook, except there weren't any pictures, there weren't any videos, there wasn't any sound. It was all text. But we would have raging discussions on these networks, and anybody could say anything they wanted. And there was no way that anybody could censor it or fact check it or do anything. It was just very freewheeling and very open. And I remembered that. And I thought, well, that's the kind of thing we need. And about a year ago, I said something like that on Twitter, risking, of course, getting blocked and getting suppressed. But I said something like that on Twitter, and somebody fired back and said, well, have you heard of Nostr? And I had not, so I started looking things up. I said, okay, what is this like? And as I read the documents that Fiat Jaff had put out there and a few other people have added to, I thought, well, this sounds pretty interesting, but there's not a lot of tooling. So I thought, I'm going to write myself a client for this network, see if I can figure out WebSockets and Bitcoin cryptography and all of this crazy stuff in order to get a client put together. And I started fiddling around with it and actually made some progress. And then I started talking about that on Twitter and getting, you know, the people on Twitter thinking, oh my God, so maybe we should have a different network. And of course, in the early days, that was laughed off the screen. And then of course, Elon Musk buys Twitter and one side of the political aisle goes absolutely crazy and they all move to Mastodon. And the other side of the political aisle is looking around on Twitter and thinking, hey, it's actually kind of nice around here now. And meanwhile, I'm sitting there going, no, it's all going to be on Nostr, guys. It's got to be there because you never know what these guys who run these networks are going to do next. And so that's really what made it interesting for me. A Nostr is a network that nobody can tamper with reliably. You know, you could probably tamper with a relay, but you can't tamper with the whole network. There's no way to do it. And that's why I like it.
Cool. All right. I got a list of questions from the community.
Right? Well, hang on a minute. Let me just say this one thing here. This business of, you know, free interchange of information is a double-edged sword, right? You're going to be able to say whatever you want, but so's everybody else. And you're going to have to be able to live with that. And that means that terrorists can use it to organize. You'll have to live with that as well. And porn people are going to be able to use it. And you'll have to live with that as well. But it seems to me that that's a better alternative than living with the censors who will push their own stupid agendas. Okay, I'm done. Thank you.
Right. Oh, that's fine. I'm totally chill with that. So do you think that this will be something in 10 years? That's what people are curious about. What possibilities do you think there will be like in 10 years? Would Nostr lead the way? Would there be other networks that will adapt? Any like thoughts around this?
Well, I think it's impossible to say what's going to happen in 10 years, but I think the idea of untamperable distributed networks is clearly the only way to do a free speech and open exchange environment. So whether it's Nostr or something else, you know, someone could invent some newer technology that outdoes Nostr, but that's just the way of the world. I am convinced that this kind of network, distributed, everybody can put their own relay up, everybody can send their own messages. I believe that is the future going into, you know, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. God knows what kind of network we'll have by then.
Yeah. What will things look like in the year 3000?
Yeah, well.
Will it all be robots? Right. I mean, that's another question.
Is any any indication. Not of ChatGPT.
Yeah, so this is right? Exactly. So people have been asking a lot about ChatGPT. I've had the same questions. In fact, you know, like the community members are stressing out. Someone asked, can you consider what is the short-term future of generative tech, ChatGPT? Do you think it'll make it programs more productive, more stupid, both or neither? A, B, C, or D? I'll let you take it from there.
Well, you know, ChatGPT, all of these funny little AIs are interesting tools. If you use it as a tool, you may get some benefit out of it. What I have discovered about ChatGPT in particular is that it is not above lying to you. It'll tell you something that's completely wrong. Yeah. If you ask it to generate some code, it'll generate code for you, but you better read that code and understand it because it's crap.
Oh yeah.
You know, if you ask it a very focused question, you might get a reasonable answer.
I was just wondering, Bob, if you've like thought about how deeply you've thought about the censorship resistance. It's censorship resistant compared to the current social platforms, but against a state actor, have you thought about that?
A state actor can wield power that is essentially infinite. And, you know, if the state actor decides that no one can use the internet except the way they say, they will be able to enforce that with 85, 90% reliability. Then there are the people who understand what that network is and how to thwart it, who will be able to subvert that. And they will do so at great personal risk, but they will do so anyway. And they will become the French resistance of the internet. And there'll be no way that the government officials will be able to completely rein that in. Now, you know, whether Noster goes in that direction or whether it's something completely different, I don't know. I imagine it would be something completely different. I am not worried about the Western world going quite that far. Western society has done pretty well over the last century and a half. I don't think it's going to go down that rat hole. Is it possible? Yes, but that's not what I anticipate. I do expect, however, that there will be forces in the Western world that we see today that will attempt to suppress information and suppress, call it disinformation and call it misinformation and call it every name under the book and fact check it left and right. I expect that to happen. And I expect them to be able to do nothing at all about Noster.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah. So there was an interview with Smackers, one of the people that we know. And he also brought up the same concept about the threat model with IP address attacks and relays. And Fiat Joff actually countered that by saying, well, you can just keep moving, you know, keep rotating your relays and then the information will be out there, which I find very interesting because it made me think about this one case where, a website called Sci-Hub. Maybe you heard about this. It was created by Alexandra Elbakan out in Kazakhstan, where she put all the scientific research papers on a website. And the publishers kept on filing lawsuits against her, but she's out in Kazakhstan. And they kept rotating all of the like IP addresses and the domain names. And still until like it's been going on for at least like since 2016 or so. So 7 years. And with so many attempts by, I think, you know, not sure if it goes all the way to the government level, but takedown requests, it hasn't been taken down and people can go there and freely access these research papers, which would, you know, normally cost maybe like $50 or, you know, dollars or more to get at a publisher like Science Magazine or Nature. So, you know, I think that if something like that can last as long as it does and keep rotating its addresses, maybe, you know, with Noster as big as it is, because we have over 1,000 or almost 1,000 relays at this point, you know, I'm thinking that this could possibly work.
I think it'll work. You know, a state actor could put an awful lot of pressure on that. if, you know, if they really wanted to shut this lady down, they could probably put an awful lot of pressure on her. But as long as the state actor is not willing to spend several billion dollars on it, then probably it's going to be easy to dodge. Once they do want to spend that much money on it, it won't be as easy to dodge, but it will always be possible to dodge. People are very clever. They will find ways to sneak things into the internet that no one can track and no one knows is there.
Okay. How if we shift gears a bit? And a common question I get is, do you have any advice for people learning to program? And maybe we can talk a little bit about SICP, you know, structure and interpretation of computer programs, by Abelson and Sussman, which is a classic, and your thoughts around that. I read that when I was an undergrad. Great book, you know, set me on the right track to think about computing in general and data and structures. Very fortunate to have had that kind of training. But I feel like, you know, these days people are like, oh, why go back to something that's so ancient? And, you know, a lot of people actually flunked out of that class when I took it because it's you're laughing, right? It's not easy. You know, it's not easy. And I'm like, well, what was it about it that I got that, you know, like other people didn't get? I'm like, where, you know, why is it so difficult? Because, you know, after so many decades, we only have 0.5% of the world's population who are actually active programmers. So I was wondering what are you laughing about that? But it's so true, right? You know, I talk to people all the time. They're like, I'm going to learn how to program this year. I'm like, great, good for you. And then 2 weeks later, they just disappear. They're like, oh my God, I just can't handle it. So any thoughts around that? Would love to hear your input.
Oh, heavens, you want to start me on an hour-long lecture. So first of all, you know, 0.5% of the world's population is a programmer. But when I started programming, it was not, you know, 0.5% or 0.1% or 0.1000% or 0.1000%. There were maybe 10,000 programmers in the world, maybe, when I started this back in the 1960s. And now, of course, we can measure the number of programmers in a percentage of the population of the world. That is a remarkable statement. And then to add to that, the number of programmers in the world doubles at a rate of about once every 5 years. So 5 years from now, it'll be 1%. 10 years from now, it'll be 2%. And that number is going to grow pretty damn fast, unless something happens to slow that growth. But so far, nothing has. So I expect that number to continue to grow and grow until we have to actually start recruiting more women, because that's half the world and they're not seeming to join our ranks.
I don't understand that still. I mean, it was like totally cool when I was doing it, but maybe I'm just weird.
I don't understand it either.
Yeah, I look at your solid principles and I was like, what's solid? Because I didn't know what you had written. And I was like, isn't the L in solid Liskov substitution principle? And like, isn't that Barbara Liskov?
Yes, so yes, like, is.
Yeah, like, I don't get it. It's fantastic though. Go ahead.
The numbers in the US are just abysmal as far as women in the industry. You know, it's like 2-4%. It's a very, very small number. Maybe it's gotten better in the last few years, but the last time I did a serious study on it, it was terrible. And that's a reversal from what it was in the 50s. Because in the 1950s, virtually all programmers were women, because the men built the hardware and the women, you know, made the hardware work. And when I first got a job as a programmer a long, long time ago, half the programmers were women. And they were all in their 30s and 40s, by the way. And then later on, about 10 years after that, I saw those numbers change dramatically. So I look at the change in the demographics as happening in the mid-70s. Other people put it in the early 80s. I think it happened long before that. Some people will blame the personal computer and think, well, it was marketed towards boys. But I saw it happen before that. So I can't rationalize that one. So you asked me when we started this, What advice I would have for programmers, you know, how do you get into being a programmer? What do you do as a programmer? And there are so many things to say about that. Number one, read, read a lot and read old stuff. You know, there's our industry is this industry that pretends to be modern, but it is not modern. The things that we do, the code that we write is old. You know, back in the 60s and in the 50s, they were writing if statements, they were writing while loops, they were writing assignment statements. And what we do today is write if statements and while loops and assignment statements. We might write a few more of them and we might have slightly fancier languages, but it's essentially the same thing. And the insights that those people had in the 1950s and 60s and 70s are as valid today as they were back then. It is tempting, especially for young people, to think that, oh no, it's all different now. And it's not. It's not different at all. So a book like SICP, right? The structure and interpretation of computer programs is remarkably relevant, even though it's what, 25, 30 years old. It is remarkably relevant. You mentioned that book. I had been a programmer for 30 years before I saw that book. And it changed my life. Yeah, I didn't think that, you know, something written decades before was going to have a profound effect on the way I conceived of programming. But here's this book, and it just changed the way I thought about it. It was a remarkable book for me to read. And I read it at light speed. I was throwing those pages. I was almost cheering as I read it because it was so influential and so powerful. And the things they were saying in that book resonated with my past 30 years of experience in a way that maybe somebody reading it for the first time when they're starting their career wouldn't have had that interesting experiential resonance. But it really did change my whole aspect on how software should be written and what software is. So that's a book that everybody ought to read. Just that one. And it's free. You can get it on the internet for nothing, right? They just released it to everybody.
Yeah, it's freely available, but they also have an updated version that's in JavaScript. And I didn't know it. I was like, oh no, what happened?
Yeah, exactly. Someone is missing the point somewhere.
Right. So like, can you go into a little more detail about like, how did that influence you? Did it influence the clean code that you started to write later, the clean architecture books?
Not particularly. The stuff in clean code and clean architecture is very old, very, you know, ancient wisdom that was coined by lots and lots of other people, which I just managed to kind of gather into book and give it a snappy title so that people bought it. The stuff in SICP, Structure Interpretation of Computer Programs, goes much, much deeper than that. It's a very profound kind of lesson. And to give you a sense of that, I read through it, and like I said, I was just throwing the pages. It was so exciting for me to read. But I read through it, and I worked through all the examples, and it's this language, you know, Scheme, which is a very pretty language. And I was very intrigued by it all. And I really enjoyed example after example after example. And then you get to page, I think it was 250 something. And they stop. They just slam on the brakes. And they say, okay, this has been fun, but now we have to do something that's going to really damage everything. It's going to throw a horrible monkey wrench into everything you've learned so far. And they introduce their first assignment statement. And I was absolutely floored. It's like, what? All this code that I have written for the last or read for the last 250 pages, there was no assignment anywhere in any of that. And I had to go back. I had to go back and check. No, they didn't put any assignment. They did all kinds of stuff. There was no assignment anywhere in there. I thought, oh my God, I'd never seen that before. You know, and I looked at functional programming and I kind of thought I understood what functional programming was, but I always had my doubts. And here I am at this in this book, and they slam on the brakes in this beautiful climax. And then they introduce their first assignment, and then they explain why that's problematic and what goes wrong when you assign it, when you mutate the state of a variable, and why that's a why that's breaks the model of computing in a profound way. And then they work you into it. Okay, now we're going to do a little of this and some more assignment. Okay. And they go through a few more examples. And then they slam on the brakes again 50 pages later, and they introduce their first threats. And I thought it was remarkably profound that they equated assignment and threads as being equally deleterious to software in general. They are equal evils. So that's just one of the things that had me quivering when I read this book.
I noticed that you're using Clojure for something you're working on. With Nosset. What is that, because you wanted to use functional stuff, or like, do you have a lambda calculus kind of thing going on there, or like, what was the, what are you thinking about that?
Well, I read SICP, it must be 20 years ago now, maybe 18, something like that. And I thought, okay, I really like this. I like this style. I'm going to have to reinvestigate functional programming. And that means I'm going to have to deal with Lisp. And I, you know, for years and years, I had avoided Lisp because, you know, who wants to deal with all those horrible parentheses, right? So, okay, fine. I'm going to have to
make
deal with
Lisp. Make Emacs great again. Sorry, I had to just say that.
And I was an Emacs bigot. I was an Emacs guy. I knew Emacs left and right, but I never did the MList thing. I never got into the Lisp inside of Emacs. So I was like, all right, I'm going to have to learn Lisp. And I look around and there's a couple of Lisps out there, and I just happened to run into this Clojure thing. And I knew Rich Hickey. It was a very indirect thing. I knew Rich Hickey because he and I had exchanged views 20 years before on that social network that I was talking about, Usenet. You know, he was a C++ guy or a C guy, and I was a C++ or a C guy, and we bantered back and forth about the right way to do, you know, C++ or C. And I always found what he wrote to be insightful. And then he disappeared from the scene as far as I was concerned. And all of a sudden, here I am looking for a Lisp that I can use. And oh, Rich Hickey. Oh, he wrote a Lisp. Oh, it works on the JVM. Well, that would be convenient. And so I just started to fiddle with it. And this is like, you know, 12, 13 years ago. Start to fiddle with the language. And I bumped into Stu Holloway and a few of the other guys who were involved in Clojure. And I thought, you know, this is a good group of guys. I like what they're doing. And I just started using the language. And at first I was just playing around with it. And then I started doing more serious things with it. And then I got my compatriots to start using the language, and you know, they got a little more interested in it. And it's just been this growing kind of love affair with this really well-structured language that Rich and the guys have done a really, really good job with. And it's remarkable how well they've kept their principles going in this language. So I'm a big fan at the moment. I think it's a great language.
One of my friends is like, he got into Clojure like probably around the same time, like, I don't know, 10 years ago. And he just couldn't stop talking about it. And I dabbled with it back then. But then, like, yeah, one of the jokes was like, I don't even see the brackets anymore. I just see blonde, brunette, redhead.
Yeah, well, it is nice that they managed to use a few different kinds of brackets, because in Scheme, it would all be parentheses. And in Clojure, at least you've got some square brackets and some curly brackets to break up the monotony of all those closing parentheses at the end. but you know, after a while, you just kind of, okay, yep, I see them. I understand why they're there. There aren't really any more of them than there would be in Java or JavaScript or something like that. They're just in a different place. And they're fine that way. So, you know, you do get used to it.
Yeah.
And it does.
One of the things I remembered about Scheme, like early on when I learned, was the very first thing they kept on telling us is, do not fixate on syntax. That's why you're here. Do not fixate on syntax. Look at the concept and don't memorize anything.
Did you ever watch the videos by Abelson and Sussman that walk through SICP, those old MIT videos where they're writing lists, they're writing Scheme on the blackboard? And they sit there and they draw those parentheses at the end. Wheat, wheat, wheat.
I was just wondering if you've looked at like TLA Plus for formal specifications.
I have not. It has been mentioned to me several times, but I have never taken the time to look at the language and understand, you know, why it's there or what it's trying to achieve. I have my own doubts about formal specifications in general. Dijkstra went down this rat hole and it nearly killed him. And so I am fearful of what it might mean.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so let's switch gears here a bit. One question from our Nostr community, Jack Chickney, or Chickney, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name right. He asks, so who drew the profile picture with the guy with the big head on your website?
So that is a picture that was drawn freehand at a conference I went to 5 years ago in Lithuania. And I gave a keynote there and you know, just a lot of fun to be there. And at the end of it, they just handed me that picture. And it's such a good picture. It's such a good picture of me that I've got it sitting here on my desk. It's right there. And I appreciate it whenever I see it. And I've used it as an avatar ever since.
Cool. And I was wondering, like, do you have any thoughts of like what you would want the Nostr development community to focus on more? Or, you know, I'm just curious if you've seen things that come out that are great, or you've seen, you know, development that's not so hot. Like what do you see that's going on that you're excited about? Anything you want to talk about there and you want to share with people?
The Nostr development community is alive. It is full of energy and possibility. There are more ideas coming out in a day than you can possibly absorb. Some of the chat areas on the GitHub site just explode. I can't follow it all. And then if I look on the Nostr messages that I follow a lot of those developers, they're just spouting things left and right and coming up with this idea and that idea. And I'm thinking, well, I'm writing a client. There's no way I'm going to be able to integrate all this stuff into my client. So I'm just going to plod along and you know, take some of the better ideas and add them to what I think is a good idea for my own entertainment. Do I have advice for them? No. Keep on being as creative as possible. These guys are the opposite of ChatGPT, right? They are making stuff that's new. They're inventing. They're wildly creative. So yeah, keep going, guys. You're doing great stuff.
Do you want to talk about what you're building on Nostr?
The thing I'm building is called More Speech. You know, the best solution to bad speech is more speech. So that's the name of the tool. And it's a desktop tool for interacting with Nostr. So you can take the tool and attach it to a bunch of relays. And up on your screen will come a list of all the messages. And you can click on a message and see it in its full glory and respond to it and DM and like things and so on. It is, however, not modeled after Twitter. It is not modeled after Facebook. The tools that are out there, the clients that are out there right now, the ones that I've interacted with anyway, look like they're trying to look like Twitter or look like Facebook. You know, they have that feel to them, the chatty kind of feel. And I'm looking at it very differently. I'm looking at it as a large integrator of hundreds of messages, hundreds or thousands of messages that you can scroll through and see the headlines of, and then pick one that you want and dig deep. What I'm looking to do here is create what we had in the 1970s and the 1980s, that net news environment that I was talking about earlier, where we could focus in on a topic and then see the thread of articles for that topic and drill down and drill down and drill down and respond to each other in this wild thread of information. And in those days, the threads would go for hundreds of messages and they would branch and bifurcate and reunify, and they would just literally go everywhere. A thread could last for many, many months. And that's the kind of thing I'm looking to build with More Speech. I'm not interested in the, oh, here's a message. Oh, my dog got a bath. Oh, you know, I did this today. Yeah. That's not what I'm interested in. You know, I want to start a serious conversation and have that conversation last for months in a thread. So that's the emphasis that I am taking with it. And what's fascinating to me about this is that Noster is perfect for that. And it's also perfect for a Twitter thing. And it's also perfect for everything else. I mean, the clients that are popping up have so much interesting variety. And we haven't scratched the surface of this yet.
Yeah. So, you know, like Usenet, great days, where there's just insane threads, but it was really hard to find things too. Like, are you thinking about this problem in CyberClient of how to search or like sharing across relays?
Oh, the whole relay thing, we're going to have to figure that one out.
That's yeah.
Really frustrating right now. Because I can see threads building, but then there's a message that I simply can't see. And I don't know what relay it came in on. I can see the ID of the message. Okay, somebody's responding to this message and it has a certain ID, but I don't know where that message is. I cannot find it. And it's on some relay that I'm not subscribed to, and I don't know what relay it is. Yep. So that we're going to have to solve. And Mike Dilger, I think, has some really good ideas about this. Did I say his name right? Mike Dilger. I'm pretty sure that's his name.
Mike Dilger. Yeah. We did an interview with him, I think, last week.
Yeah, you did.
About the gossip client. And very useful tool when the network went kind of crazy and I lost my relays.
Yeah, I mean, we were all attached to a whole bunch of relays, and then those relays became instantly unusable.
Yeah.
As soon as Jack Dorsey joined. Right? Or no, as soon as Will released Damus.
yeah, the China influx just completely spammed the network pretty hard.
But I know, watch how fast the developers and the network responded to that. All of a sudden, we've got the paid relays. They just popped up. And, you know, I'm signed up to all those, I'm signed up to a lot of paid relays. There's probably a bunch I don't know about. And that has really made the network continue to be usable while those other relays are getting slammed. And I can still converse with people. I just can't find all the relays I want.
I set up I'm building something at the moment, and I set up a private relay. Like, I didn't publish it anywhere. Well, it's not private. It's just like, it's unpublished. And then somehow I'm getting Chinese spam on it. I don't even know how they found this relay.
you can blame it on the stats guy. I think like, the thing is that he aggregates all the relays, so he knows where all of them are. Like every single time somebody posts something, you know, and if they have relay hints or they have that relay list, they keep aggregating them. And I think that list is somewhere. So if these Chinese spam bots saw your relay, they might come after you, even if you don't want to share it with them.
It's just amazing, right? So how many people are on Noster now? It's got to be hundreds of thousands, if not, you know, pushing a million.
Yeah. So if you go to noster.bands, you know, /stats.html, it actually shows you the daily stats of how many actual pub keys are writing, I think, including the spammy ones, because Arthur actually qualifies different kinds of pub keys, ones that are high quality, and there's ones who are just randomly writing crap to the network. And I think it's over a million active pub keys they're writing. But if you actually look at the ones who are, you know, quality end pubs with a profile, it's more like 500,000. And activity daily is down. Yeah.
Half a million. Wow.
Yeah. But not everyone's writing every day. It's like maybe 20,000 with profiles that are actually writing every day.
Well, you know what, a year ago it was 50.
Like, not a a little tiny dot on the graph.
Yeah. So, you know, something about it is working. And, you know, the scaling issues are, they're going to hit us again and again, because, you know, we, every time we grow by an order of magnitude, we're going to have another scaling issue to deal with. But so far, so good. I mean, the scaling has worked, and the way that people are dealing with it has been working. So good news all around, I think.
Yeah, I think it's reaching some kind of inflection point where it becomes, or maybe it's already become anti-fragile, because the community itself is just sort of, the community is centered on some ideas rather than any particular technology or anything. So it's just like, we're going to figure it out.
Well, it's gotten from being a curiosity and a kind of a fun little project and oh, isn't it neat? I can talk to these guys. Okay, fine. To something that you actually rely on every day. And once you cross that boundary, then yeah, people are going to fight like crazy to figure out how to keep it alive and growing and being ever more useful.
So do you have you thought about like the what like emergent properties might come up from this network? Like,
here you've got a mechanism where people can communicate uninhibited across the globe almost instantly. And you know, that's what we thought the internet was going to be. And for a while it was, and the possibilities were enormous. And then the big tech guys clamped down and did their nasty little dirty deeds. And now here we are again. And what is going to emerge out of this? I have no idea. I can't even anticipate it. I've seen JB55. Will has said some things about how he likes to just have little private relays here and there, and he'll control things in his house with them. I think that's really interesting. Could you know, the Internet of Things, you know, the whole Internet of Things thing. Wouldn't it be interesting if that turned out to be one of the use cases for Noster, right? So that you can be absolutely sure that when you set your thermostat, it's you setting your thermostat and nobody else can set your thermostat. And nobody can use your thermostat to do denial of service attacks on other people, which they can right now. Right? I think that's very interesting.
Yeah, and also like it's showing the whole Web3 crowd that actually you don't need to put all your data on a blockchain to prove that like it's your data, like that you're the originator of the data. Like you just need signed messages. You don't really need anything else.
Blockchains have their purpose, but yeah, if you can sign the message and prove that you're the owner of that message, you know, that solves so many problems with the crazy hacky community we've got right now.
Have you looked at the Church-Rosser theorem?
The who theorem?
Church-Rosser.
Church-Rosser.
Yeah.
No, okay. I thought you were saying the Church-Turing.
Church-Turing, yeah.
Is that what you meant, Church Turing?
No, I meant Church-Rosser. But Church.
Okay, yeah, I don't know what that is.
Ricardo has a question from our group chat. What's the book you're currently working on, and when's it coming out?
So the book I just finished is called Functional Design, and it is a way to take the principles of design that we have used for the last 20, 30 years in non-functional languages and apply them to functional languages. So I go through, you know, why do we have functional languages? What are the characteristics of functional languages? What is it that makes them functional? How does that differentiate from non-functional languages? Now, how do we deal with design principles? All those same principles, how do they apply to a functional language? And what about design patterns? All those patterns that we learned in 1995, do they still apply? And if so, how do they apply? How should you structure and modularize your functional program so that you can take advantage of everything we've learned over the last 30 years? That's what that book is all about. And of course, the language is almost entirely Clojure, except for the first couple of chapters where I actually write some C and a little bit of Java.
I keep thinking, like, 1995, why is it always that year? It feels like that was a critical turning point.
1995, the mid-90s was a critical turning point for a number of things. One of them was design patterns. That came out right about then. And it was a deeply profound work that many people now poo-poo, and they do so to their peril, right? Because they shouldn't be poo-pooing that work. It is a remarkable work. The other thing that happened in the mid-90s was the Agile Revolution. That's when all the old guys like me, who had been burning themselves out for 30 years trying to do waterfall, finally put their foot down and said, we're not doing that anymore. There's got to be a better idea. And then we looked back into the 1950s and saw they had the solution all along. And we brought that forward into the future, and we called it Agile.
Yeah. Actually, you just jogged my memory. I thought I would also mention the mythical man month, if you want to talk about that a bit. I don't think a lot of younger generation people know about it.
What a wonderful book. Now, that's written by, his name is going to escape me for the moment, but the guy who wrote that was the guy who wrote the very first virtual memory operating system, the very first computer that had memory protect hardware and that you could adjust the address space and move it around so that you could do virtual memory. And he, at IBM, he ran the group that put that together for IBM 370 DOS, right? And remarkable work. And then from that experience and several others, he writes this book called The Mythical Man Month, which some of which is very good and some of which you scratch your head over nowadays and go, well, did he really mean that? Like the crazy idea, maybe it's not a crazy idea, but the idea that programming teams should have a chief programmer and a bunch of programmer slaves around the chief programmer. And the premise there was that there are certain people who can write code 10 times faster than the normal person, and they should be chief programmers. And then the normal people should be around that person doing little tasks. That person can farm out little tasks to the minions around the outside. I'm not sure that's a great idea, but some of the other ideas in that book were terrific. And then he did a second edition. Gosh, I think that was in the 90s that he did the second edition. What's the author's name? I still can't pull it into my head.
It's Fred Brooks.
Fred Brooks. Frederick Brooks.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, great book altogether, but some interesting, you know, ideas in there that maybe don't work so well. And Fred Brooks, of course, is responsible for Brooks Law, right? Which adding manpower to a late project makes it later.
I wanted to ask you, with Agile, like how did this turn into like what we've got now, which is like everyone's using Scrum and all this stuff, like which seems to be a complete I can't do it. Like it's horrible. Like what happened there?
So the whole Agile movement was a reaction to, you know, the travails of waterfall that had been foisted upon us in the 1970s. We actually foisted it upon ourselves in the 1970s, and then we tried for three decades to make it work and couldn't make it work properly, and finally said, well, no, let's look at how guys actually got things done in the 1950s and 60s, we could do this iterative thing. We could measure what we got done every week and use that as a way to project forward in time. What a thought. And Kent Beck was the guy who really codified it well. He wrote the book Extreme Programming Explained in 1999, and that really did set the stage for this whole Agile movement. If you look at extreme programming, that is the definition of Agile. And everything else that's come along since or even before is a subset of what Kent had put in that original book. So we have our meeting in February. A bunch of us get together. We name it Agile. We write the Agile Manifesto. We put that on a website. Ward Cunningham says, hey, I'm going to get people to sign this website because, you know, modifiable websites were a brand new thing then. And so he writes some Perl code so that people can actually sign this website. And to our great surprise, tens of thousands of people sign this website. Yeah, the idea that you're going to have a meeting somewhere, you know, a bunch of consultants have a meeting and something actually is going to come from it is a pretty The odds are very low. I've been to a lot of meetings like that where nothing ever comes from it. But here's one where the magic happened and everybody signed the doggone thing. And then, of course, what happens is the marketing people come along. Guys want to make money at this stuff, and you can't blame them for that. Ken Schwaber came to me in about 2002 and said, Bob, I want to use one of your classrooms. I was running a training company at the time. I had a whole bunch of classrooms. He said, I want to use one of your classrooms. I'm going to teach this class called the Certified Scrum Master class. And I'll let all of your guys, all of your trainers can attend for free if you let me use a classroom. So I said, yeah, go ahead. I thought it was the dumbest idea that I'd ever heard. Right? It was just certified? Who wants to certify something? And a scrum master? What the devil is a scrum master? But okay, he's a friend of mine, and he was there at the meeting in Snowbird where we coined Agile. So, okay, fine, Ken, go ahead and do that. And I didn't happen to go to that class because I had to be somewhere else. Lo and behold, this thing just captures everybody's imagination, not programmers, project managers. Project managers thought this was the best thing in the world. Oh my God, we can put this on our resumes, another thing to put on our resumes. We are scrum masters now. And the project managers invaded the space. Agile had been the domain of programmers. Programmers are the ones who promoted it. All of us at that Agile meeting were programmers. We were all techies. We all thought, hey, this is the idea, this is the best way to run a project. You know, let the techies decide. And the project managers invaded at that point. They took over the conferences. They took over the messaging. They took over everything. And that's really what happened to Scrum. Scrum is not necessarily a bad idea if you go back to the original work by, you know, Martine DeVoe and Ken Schwaber and Jeff Sutherland, and they wrote it up in 1995 and submitted at a design patterns conference, as a matter of fact. And then it was a fine idea back then. It was a nice little subset of what we would think of as Agile now, a subset of extreme programming. And the project managers just came in there and they thought, no, this is a people thing and we're going to expand it, and really kind of wrecked it. Kent Beck said at the Agile meeting in Snowbird in February of 2001, right, Kent Beck said, the reason we are doing this is to heal the divide between business and tech, business and programming. And when the project managers invaded, they did the exact opposite. They worsened the divide between business and programming. They put themselves in the middle. And that kind of wrecked it all. And then, of course, all the consultants have to jump in and they've got to put adjectives in front of it. So there's this kind of agile and that kind of agile and modern agile and wise agile and your dog's bath kind of agile and agile with all kinds of different adjectives, because the consultants have to differentiate themselves from one another. And that's led to an awful lot of confusion. And so I wrote the book, man, what, 5 years ago now, right? Clean Agile, right? Which is just a restatement of Kent Beck's Extreme Programming Explained 20 years later. as a way to get everybody to focus back on what the idea actually was at the beginning and why we did it and what the principles really are. And so they can see that and look at the horizon full of all of these agile techniques that everybody's spouting and be able to differentiate, you know, with the wheat from the chaff.
Yeah. So I just asked in a group chat if anyone else had any questions, and Fiat Jeff has a question, which you've sort of touched on already, but like, he's asking like, have you looked at the approaches to decentralized social networks before Nostr, and did you pay attention to these, and like, what do you think in comparison to Nostr?
I haven't looked at any of the modern ones. You know, I haven't looked at Mastodon. I've heard that it's not very decentralized, or it's kind of quasi-decentralized, but I really haven't studied it at all. I grew up with a decentralized network. The Usenet, the UUNet system that I talked about earlier, that was entirely decentralized. There was no way anybody was getting their arms around that. Right, it was just spread to the winds. It's completely decentralized. So I was very used to that kind of model. And that's why when I saw Nostr, I thought, ah, okay, here we've got something that we had back in the 70s and we could have again. Maybe with a little bit better in it because you can sign your documents, whereas before you couldn't. In Usenet, anybody could have hacked into it and forged your articles, which didn't happen very often as far as I know. But yeah, I haven't looked at anything else. Obviously, I did a deep dive into the Bitcoin protocols early on before I put any money in it. And I thought, well, okay, that's pretty interesting. That's a nice decentralized way of generating trust. So, okay, I liked that.
So is this your first foray into Bitcoin, or you were in Bitcoin before you started working on Nostr?
I was into Bitcoin before I started working on Nostr by about a year. My sons, to their credit, kept on telling me, you know, Dad, you've got to get into Bitcoin. You really need to get into Bitcoin. And I looked at them like they were nuts, right? Because there's no value, but there's nothing of substance. It's just numbers. And they tried to explain it to me. And once they got my attention, I did a deep dive into the protocol. And I came out the back end of that going, oh, yeah, I see where this is going and why it's valuable. So, you know, I put my toe in the water. And actually, I think I put half of my right leg in the water became a Bitcoin owner and a few other cryptos as well, but Bitcoin primarily. Which, I'm not going to look at the value of Bitcoin right now.
Was this in 21 during the bull market, I suppose?
It was before that, but I did experience the joy of the bull market and then the, you know.
Oh, that's good. That's good. I'm curious to know what you think about Lightning, Lightning integration with Nostr. Any thoughts around that and your experiences?
It's so much fun to watch these guys zapping each other. Zap me, I'll zap you. No, well, we'll just zap each other. And so I thought, okay, all right, I've got a Bitcoin wallet. It can do Lightning. I'm gonna set up a Lightning address in nostrplebs.com, right? Okay, I can do that. And I can set it up in Deimos. And turns out that the wallet I was using was Exodus, and Exodus doesn't do Lightning very well. You can't create
a That's Lightning. A shitcoin wallet, really. I hate to say that, but it is.
That's a term that I've learned. Being on Nostr, I've learned that term, the shitcoin and the Bitcoin. Okay.
Are you running your own Bitcoin node yet?
No, I'm not running a Bitcoin node. Although my son is, he heats his house with it. He's got a couple of miners.
He's a miner.
Yeah, he's got some miners, and he puts them in an oil bath and runs the oil around his house and heats his house with it. So I lost my train of thought. I don't know what we were talking about.
We were talking about Lightning, and I was curious to know if you had looked into Lightning's architecture, any thoughts around Lightning, if you had gotten deeply into it as well.
I don't know much about the Lightning architecture. I kind of get the idea behind it, but I didn't do the same kind of deep dive into Lightning that I did into Bitcoin. Like, I understand Bitcoin and why it's valuable, and I think I get the gist of Lightning and how it can be used. So I couldn't use Exodus, so I thought, okay, what should I use? And I asked on Nostr, and people said, well, there's a whole bunch of them. And they mentioned the wallet of Satoshi. And I looked at a few of the others and I thought, well, that's probably the best one to use. So I downloaded it and I got it up and running. And then I thought, well, does it work? And I don't know if it works, and I can't access it from Exodus. So I sent a note out on Nostr. I said, well, can you send me a sat? I just want to test my wallet. Can everybody send me a sat? And I think I got 789 sats out of the deal, which is 19
cents. Can you pay my coffee? I think that was one of the best cases early on when people started posting invoices. This guy said, can you pay my coffee? And you know, someone's like, yeah, sure. And they paid the Lightning invoice. And then someone else wrote, God damn it, you beat me to it. I want to pay the invoice before you did. And someone said, oh my gosh, people are competing to pay other people's invoices. This is so surreal.
Well, it is pretty interesting. And then so yesterday, I think it was, I had a programming problem I couldn't get more speech to attach to Snort Social. And every time it would attach, it would just hang up. And I asked the question out on Noster, and somebody said, oh, yeah, you've got to have the origin tag in your HTTP headers. And I thought, what? Okay. And I wrote a little bit of code to put the origin tag in the HTTP headers, and it worked.
And, wait, oh, is this for the great. For the relay or for the not the client, right? For the relay, no, right? The
relay.
Okay.
Yeah, relay. Okay. Relay.sort.social, right? I couldn't attach to it. I couldn't get to that relay. And so I put the origin in the header, and that worked. And all of a sudden, I could talk to the Snort Social relay, and I thought, okay, that's great. And I went back to the guy, and I said, hey, you're my hero of the morning, and I sent him 500 sats.
Yeah.
Just because there you that's go. What you do now. And I think that's great. I think it's a terrific thing. Right? It'd be really yeah. easy to send people, you know, little tips and little bits of this and that. It's a little bit extra attaboy. And, you know, you could probably pay people for significant work that way. So I'm all for it. Good stuff.
Great. That makes me feel good. Like, I've been sitting on Lightning and working with Lightning for the last 2 years. And sometimes people have been saying, oh, this thing's useless. No one's ever going to use it. And now everybody's using it. So it's great.
I think they're going to use it.
Yeah.
All the non-stretches will use it.
Yeah, hopefully more people who don't know about it will use it when they get onboarded to Noster.
That's yeah, I mentioned it on Twitter, and somebody sent me something about some other mechanism on Twitter that you can use, but I'd rather not use Twitter for something like that.
So Twitter people were using it, I think, back in 21 and early 22, because you can post Lightning invoices anywhere. It's just a QR code.
Right.
It doesn't
right.
matter. So it's like platform agnostic, which is really beautiful. But like the tightness of the integration, especially with NIP 57 now allowing us to see receipts, that's really powerful. And, you know, I was wondering if you had any ideas around organizations, because now that we have not only comms and we have payments and we have private relays, you could actually organize around, you know, create a decentralized organization around that. Like, let's say, you know, I'm collaborating with somebody in South Africa, I'm, you know, in the US, and, you know, they're doing some really awesome freelance work for me, and then I pay them in sats, something like that.
What could you do? Let's see now. What could you do with an unimpeded network that nobody can forge and a medium of convenient exchange? What could you build with that?
Yeah.
Let's build a civilization with that. Completely different civilization. I think the potential is enormous.
Are we having our like 1995 moment?
You saw the post that went out today. It was a picture of Martin Luther, and then another pic. And next to that was a picture of Satoshi, and then a picture of Fiat Jeff. Did you see that image? It was gorgeous.
No, I didn't.
It was saying exactly that, right? There have been these revolutions in the past, right? Martin Luther's revolution of the church, and then the currency revolution by Satoshi, and then finally the information revolution by Fiat Jeff. And the image was really spectacular, the way they had drawn it. So I thought, yeah, there's probably something to that. Is this another 1995? Are we about to embark upon a brand new world? And I think there's something to that. You know, I don't want to do too much prediction, but you look at the way Noster has grown and the crazy ideas and the wild creativity going into it, and you know, something is happening.
Yeah. Also, something's happening with the AI industry. I don't know what's going on there in detail, but apparently some $20 billion I saw was invested in the last year.
Yeah.
And can we see things like that merge? I'm just, you know, I really don't know what's going on, but curious to know if you've heard anything.
The AI stuff, you know, we go through this thing with AI every 20 years where where somebody says something profound about AI and it's going to take over, and then you realize what it really is. No, it's not. You know, fuzzy logic is not going to take over. It's not going to take over people's jobs. I'm sorry. No, language models are not going to take over people's jobs. I'm sorry. That's not going to happen. The AIs, the ChatGPTs and the Bings and the things like that are very impressive, but they are not intelligent. They are not even close to intelligent. There's no creativity in there at all. They are language models. And what that means is that they statistically string together words based on what they have read by other people without any understanding or intent. Right. They just do a statistical model of words and string them together in a way that other people have already done in the past.
Yeah.
And it's very impressive. And, you know, their ability to understand is not the right word, parse and impute meaning to words is pretty interesting. But there's no real intelligence there. So my guess is that the amount of money being sunk into that is too much. People are spending too much money on this because they have an overblown expectation, and there will be, as there always has been, a wave of disappointment to follow that.
Yeah, like FOMO
in some ways, the object-oriented revolution was on the trough of one of those disappointments. The AI stuff had come out and everybody was talking about AI back in the 70s and in the early 80s. And then it all collapsed because everybody realized they were being told a lie. And those researchers turned and they went into the object-oriented world and fueled that crazy mess for a few years.
All of that money was printed for free anyway. So that's why.
Yeah, all the big tech was way too close to the money printer. That's for sure.
But also the AI crowd, like, they're all focusing on computation as the basis for intelligence. And I think they've got it, like, just, you know, I don't know anything, but I think they've got it totally wrong. I think it's, like, the basis for intelligence is actually, like, you need to suffer first. Because it's, if you can't... like,
intelligence requires suffering. Man, life is suffering.
Oh my goodness.
You know,
this is why I'm worried about, like, if we make AI, like, if we make artificial consciousness, or it wouldn't even be artificial, it would just be consciousness. But if we create consciousness, the first thing it's going to do is ask, like, why the fuck did you create me? And why do I have to suffer?
Because life is suffering and now I'm suffering.
I was going to say, did you ever see like Avengers, the Marvel Marvel comic or TV show?
Yes.
Yeah. So there's an AI that's creating like they create a female robot called Ada, and Ada, you know, can do everything like a person pretty much. But then the robot gets hit with some magical, like, external power, and Rob's like, but I want to be human. So somehow it, like, engineers itself to be human. And then the first thing that happens, it says, oh, I feel so much pain and suffering. I don't want to be a human anymore.
Well, you know, we've seen that.
Yeah,
it's story any number of times, right? You've got Data from Star Trek who would really like to be human, and you know, Mike from The Moon is a Harsh Mistress. We've gone through that many, many times. The computer will eventually become sentient. Number 5 is alive, right? We've seen this over and over again, and it misses something, I think, which is, if you agree with the computational theory of intelligence, then you have to understand the scale of what we're talking about. The human brain is made up of a trillion neurons, and each of those neurons has tens of thousands of interconnections. And every single neuron is an information processor more powerful than an iPhone. You know, this is an immense amount of computational power in a human brain. Nothing that we have comes close. So maybe intelligence is just a computational problem, but we do not have the facilities at this point to come even close to the amount of computing power that sits in that, you know, slushy matter inside our skulls.
Yeah, this starts to make me think about the Society of Mind and Marvin Minsky. I don't know. It seems all too abstract in a way of what is artificial, what is intelligence. I don't know if you ever read that book.
No, I did not.
No?
I've heard people reference it, but I've never read it.
Yeah, like Marvin Minsky started one of the fathers of AI.
Yeah, I've heard the name Minsky, but I haven't really delved into that much.
There is one person who actually brought up this. I don't think he wants to be named. He said that he actually likes, he said that he thinks dynamic type systems are shitty. And that, you know, advocating unit testing and test driven development isn't that great with if you have a decent type system. And I kind of want to hear your rebuttal on that, or like what you think, if you don't mind.
Oh, heavens, you know. So this is the war that we have every 10 or 15 years. Are we going to be dynamically typed or statically typed? And back in the 90s, we all wanted to be statically typed because we'd paid the price of working in C, which was untyped. And then we went through the whole static type revolution into the 2000s and the 2010s. And then, oh no, there's Ruby, and that's dynamically typed, and it's much, much better. We've got to all be Ruby and Python programmers. And then we burned ourselves with that. And so now we have to be Swift and Dart and Kotlin programmers because it's better. It's just a pendulum that goes back and forth. And the reason that it goes back and forth is that one is not better than the other. It's an unstable situation that oscillates. Now, the Clojure solution I like, because Clojure is a dynamically typed language, but within Clojure, there is a library called Spec. And that library allows you to specify types in much more detail than any statically typed language can even approach, even Haskell. Right. You can specify types dynamically, and then you can choose as a programmer when to assert those type checks. And that is much more powerful, I think, than living in a statically typed world where the compiler decides when to apply the type checks. I would rather do that myself. I would rather be able to say, I will type check here and I will not type check over here, because I have unit tests that do that checking. But over here, I need the type checking because I can't put unit tests there, or I haven't put unit tests there, or I need both. So that is the best of both worlds, I think.
What is that based on? Is that rooted in like Lambda calculus, that those types that you're referring to in Clojure?
Well, it's written in Lisp, which is a kind of Lambda calculus. Yes, it is based on a set of assertions, and the assertions investigate your data structures and ensure that the data structures have the appropriate structure and the appropriate contents and the appropriate names, and that, you know, you can even test that certain computational relationships are in place. So, for example, if you wanted to type check a balance sheet, you know, an accounting balance sheet, you could type check the fact that the assets and the liabilities balance. If you really wanted to do that, right, you'd have to reproduce the computation. In that sense, it's another kind of unit test. So it is a set of functions that you can apply to validate the structure of a data structure. And then you can decide to apply them or not as you wish. For example, what I often do is I will put them into the pre and post conditions of a function. And that way, when the function is initially called, it checks the type. And when the function returns, it again checks the type, making sure that you've got the right type coming in and you've got the right type going out. And then in the end, you turn all those checks off when you're in production. If you want to, you don't have to.
I don't really have any other questions. but
Uncle Bob, do you have any questions for us?
Well, guys, I haven't got any idea who you are.
Ah, gee, do you want to tell him a bit about him yourself, and then I'll tell him a bit about myself.
I've got a computer science background, and I've gone deep into. I've been in Bitcoin since like around 2013. So that, and that's sort of how I got into Nostr. It was just like, wow, this is the same thing but for data. And anyway, I started the podcast. Like I was like good at sort of programming and whatever, but not that good at talking to people. So much like you should start a podcast then, since you're not very good at talking to people, that then you'll be forced to talk to people. And so I was like, hey BitCarrot, you're good at talking to people, we should do this together. So yeah, that's how this came about.
That is a very, very good idea. A programmer who cannot articulate their intentions is in trouble.
I can articulate things as long as I have enough time and I can write it down, but just I can't do it later on the fly in a conversation very well.
Yeah, and that's a problem because the people who can will override you and win the argument.
Yeah, it's tough, isn't it? Yeah, you have to be a little bit aggressive about things like that, especially I think in like, you know, programming teams. Sorry, I cut in there.
No, that's fine. Yeah, and in any kind of management situation. Right. You have to be able to have the adeptness with words to address an attack that comes at you. To do a podcast like this is a great way to do it. Writing is a great way to do it. Anything that you can do to exercise your ability with words and to assemble ideas rapidly and to communicate them forcefully is going to help you enormously in any part of your career.
Yeah. G and I, we, you know, like I got into Bitcoin and, you know, he's also part of the Bitcoin Association. We have like 20 odd friends who are all connected to us socially because we're all Bitcoiners. And Bitcoin is a pretty, you know, tight network early on, I think, especially because so many people are like, people are crazy. Like, why would you want internet money? Like, this is not real. I feel like, you know, connections there are a little bit, you know, people understand each other a little bit more because you're up against a lot of negativity from, you know, the status quo about something that's so new and so strange, like miners. Like, why would you mine something like that? Anyway.
Alrighty. So I guess we'll wrap it up.
Sounds good to me. Thank you, guys.
Yeah thank you, Bob. Really appreciate your time.
Head over to nostrovia.org to see how to follow us on all the major social credit platforms.